Live for start.
Hello, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the webinar on the ecology and behavior of elephants. So first, we'd like to request all of our participants to please change their names. You can do that by using the chat button on the bottom left corner of your screen, and this would also allow you to access the chat. And you can turn your audio and video on and off from the bottom portion of the screen, and we'd like to request you all to please mute your audio whenever during the presentation. And if you have any questions, please type them in the chat forum. And for those of our audience who are participating, who are watching the live stream from YouTube and Facebook, please type in your comments there. And so we would humbly like to welcome our guest for today, Dr. Sanjita Sharma Pokhrel. Dr. Sanjita is an elephant biologist working to understand the stress response in free-ranging Asian elephants in the forests of southern India. She completed her master's from Kurukshetra University. She has worked with the Wildlife Institute of India and with Wildlife Fund Nepal. Her PhD work, which was awarded with Nepal Vidya Bhushan in 2018, highlighted the influences of ecological and anthropogenic factors on the stress physiology of wild elephants. She also worked with Kyoto University, Japan, to develop the new technique to assess stress in captive elephants. Currently, she's working as a postdoctoral researcher at the Center for Ecological Sciences in India to address the effects of human disturbances on the health of wild Asian elephants in West Bengal landscape. She's also a cartoonist with her cartoon series called Kunti the Baby Elephant. She's trying to sensitize people about elephant ecology. So now I'd like to request Ms. Sagarika Bhatta from PowerShift Nepal to give her opening remarks to this webinar.
Thank you, Salonika, and good afternoon, everyone. Today, on behalf of Rethink NicheGut campaign, we are many organizations, groups, and members in this campaign. Those are PAN, Hari Nepal, XR, NYCA, Sustainable Week Kathmandu, Green Commando Earth, and PowerShift Nepal. On behalf of everyone, I'd like to thank you and welcome Dr. Sanjita for lending and giving a valuable time and knowledge, also having that enthusiasm to share and spread our knowledge today. Through knowledge networking series of PowerShift Nepal, we believe that the platform will inspire many youth in environmental justice, climate justice, and sustainable development in coming days as well. Today, we are here to enhance our knowledge about elephant ecology and behavior with Dr. Sanjita. Also, her experience and understanding how elephants behave and how it's important to roam freely in jungle. We all know that government of Nepal is towards cutting trees and clearing jungle to develop mega airport in NicheGut. So today, I hope with everyone, we look forward for cumulative knowledge, understanding why wildlife helps to be balance ecosystem. Hope everybody along with me, everybody learns new perspective today and hopefully could add more for our campaign in future. Once again, on behalf of everyone and PowerShift and Rethink campaign, we would like to welcome Dr. Sanjita and all online today. Looking forward to you. Over to you, Salonika.
Thank you, Ms. Sagarika. And now I'd like to invite Dr. Sanjita to give a presentation on ecology and behavior of elephants.
Namaste, Sabelai. I would like to thank Sagarika and Salonika for that wonderful introduction of mine. आज धेरै खुसी छु कि नेपालको लागि आई एम गोइङ टु रिप्रेजेन्ट एलिफेन्ट साइन्स एन्ड आई फिल रियली ह्याप्पी एन्ड आई होप यु नो आई विल टक समथिङ रियली गुड एन्ड समथिङ विच यु गाइज विल गेट इन लाइटन्ड अबाउट हाउ एलिफेन्ट बायोलोजी एन्ड इकोलोजी वर्क्स सो विथ दिस विदाउट मेकिङ वेट आई वुड लाइक टु स्टार्ट प्रेजेन्टेसन जस्ट बियर विथ मी फर सम टाइम एज आई शेयर द स्क्रिन So yeah, like I said, I'd like to thank everyone, particularly Neeraj, for giving this wonderful platform for me to come here and discuss about elephant ecology and behavior. Before I start the presentation, Salonika, am I audible and is my screen visible to everyone?
Yes, it is. Your voice awesome. Is clear and yes.
Thank you. So, like I said, today's presentation will mostly focus on the ecology and behavior of elephants, and where I would like to focus mainly on elephant, their route and development. I hope you got the gist by when I use the term development. So I have structured my presentation in such a way that I'll start with the introduction of basic elephant ecology, because I personally feel that it is very pivotal for us to understand basic elephant science before we go ahead and advocate about any mega project and how those mega projects will have influence on elephant biology. Along with that, I'll also briefly talk about my ongoing research on stress response in elephant. And most importantly, with the knowledge that I have gathered so far in the field of elephant science, I would like to discuss about elephant reaction to changing ecological context or any kind of disturbances. So with this, I'd like to start. So whenever we think about elephant, particularly in context of India and Nepal, the first thing that comes to my mind is Lord Ganesh. Lord Ganesh in Nepal is considered as Lord of prosperity, wisdom, and happiness. Similar way, the wild elephants are no less than Lord Ganesh, because there are scientific documentation, anecdotes, and stories which have proven that, you know, sense of elephant have sense of self, empathy, teamwork, grief, memories, creativity, and on the top, they are highly social animals. So to add to these points, that, you know, elephants have multiple feathers in their cap. They are also considered as umbrella species, because the conserving elephants, we are going to conserve entire habitat and also the animals living in that habitat. And similarly, they are considered as seed dispersal, because there are many plants and trees which solely rely on elephants for the germination purpose and also for the dispersal. And similarly, elephants are called ecosystem engineers, because you must have seen that, you know, like in case of savanna forest and other forests, they help to structure the entire forest. And many times the roots created by elephants are used by animals and also human beings. In one of the study in African elephant, they found that when elephants walk around in the forest, they create impression, and in that impression, many times water get accumulated and they form the puddle. And they found that such puddle is a micro habitat for more than 1,000 species of microorganism. So that means they are also a micro habitat creator. So based on all this ecological significance that our elephant have, elephant can be considered as one of these. I think somebody's video is on. Yeah, can I continue?
Salonika, yes, I'm here. Yeah, I guess you can come.
I can hear my voice. Based on this, elephants can be considered as a mega gardeners, because they have lots of ecological importance when we see that perspective. So when we see the evolution of elephants, 38 million years ago, the ancestor of elephants was of the size of pig. That is very surprising, and they did not have any trunk or tusk. But with the process of evolution, you know, after many years, they developed trunk, tusk, and there were around 350 proboscideans. However, there are some of, because of their incompetence in coping up with rapidly changing environment, we have no elephants except two species, living species of elephant, that is Asian elephants and African elephant. And since today's presentation will be mostly focusing on Asian elephant, I'll be talking about Asian elephant biology. So unlike African elephants, Asian elephant both only tusk female do not have dust. So even in case of male, there are other kind of male which doesn't have dust. So there are two kinds of male in Asian elephant: male with tusk, they are also referred as tusker, and male without tusk are known as makhna. And similarly, in this context, so it is, I think, when we are talking about the movement and Nisgard project and all this biology related stuff, I think it is important for us to understand the society of each minor detail about the elephant science. So with this, when we talk about society of elephants, they are, as I said earlier, they live in a highly bonded society. The basic unit of elephant society starts with mother and a calf. So mother and a calf come together to form a sister and their calves group, which is also known as family. And many times this family comes together, they form bond or kin group. Seasonally and occasionally, bond or kin group comes together to form a clan. So this is how the structure of elephant is. So elephant society is. So elephant society is a fluid multi-tiered. It is like a fluid fusion type of society, mostly matriarchal society. So when I say matriarchal, in the group there are lots of females, and males which are not sexually matured stay in the herd. Once they get sexually matured, they leave the herd and remain solitary throughout their life. However, you can see that, you know, sometimes such kind of solitary male get associated with herds during breeding period and also form occasional bachelor group inside the forest. So with this, let us also learn about reproductive maturity in elephant. The sexually active phase in Asian female elephant is called estrus. It has a very narrow window. It's like 16 to 18 weeks. And in this period, she needs to find a receptive male so that, you know, she can mate. And similarly, in case of male, the sexually active phase is called must. So in must, it is clearly marked by the swelling of temporal gland, and there will be a secretion from the temporal gland, which is also known as temporine hormone or pheromone. This temporine pheromone helps in signaling the reproductive state of that male to other females. And you know, in this period, elephants show a different behavior. So they change their behavior. They move around a lot in search of female, and they won't feed a lot. So you can clearly see that movement is very crucial part even when we talk about reproduction in elephants. So once they mate, they give birth to one single calf. Sometimes occasionally there are twins and all this thing. However, and the intercalving period in Asian elephants is just, you know, four to five years. And most interesting aspect is the gestation period in Asian elephants ranges from 22 to 23 months. And this is the period when female requires lots of nutrients. And for that, she again needs to move around searching for a good quality of diet. So female elephant is active, reproductively active till the age of 50. Once she crosses the age of 50, she reaches a stage called reproductive senescence. So with this, as I said, that elephants are live in a group, in a larger group, so they must communicate with each other. So the mode of communication, there are various modes of communication in Asian elephants. When they are together, they use tactile signal, and mostly they use vocalization, which is also known as acoustic signal. And like I said, in case of must elephant, they use chemical signal to actually broadcast about their reproductive and physiological state. So we should understand that, you know, movement and communication in elephant is very important when we are knowing their ecology and biology. So with this, I would like to also share with you, you know, the sad fact about elephant is the current distribution of elephants. If you can clearly see the map, you can see that, you know, the map, which is lightly red, was the historic distribution of elephants. And the pockets of darker red colors are the habitat where elephants are found now. It's unfortunate for me to say this, that elephants now are only restricted to 6% of their historical range, which touches around 13 countries. So that means their habitat is rapidly declining. And on the top of it, there's something called conservation concern. Like I said earlier when I started my presentation, elephants in India and also in Nepal are considered as God. We worship that elephant. And if I get this liberty to use the word abuse, Most of the elephants in captivity are abused because we don't understand the biology behind those elephants. So these elephants undergo various kind of harassment, and many times these elephants are also using ecological procession, religious procession, and festivals. Mostly in case of India, I have not seen much in case of Nepal. And quite similar instances, like in Nepal and India, the fringes of forest always witness this kind of interaction where elephants are harassed by the villagers. However, there is a conservation dilemma here. Whenever we see such kind of situation, most of the time we blame villagers and we say that elephants, express our sympathy towards elephant, but there is a lots of socio-economic aspect in this issue, so I won't discuss much about it. And on the top, along with this situation in elephants, there are things like poaching. Elephants are poached for ivory, skin, and also meat. So now, since we know that their habitat is rapidly declining and we have such kind of conservation concerns, which we are, you know, unable to address, so this is where it is important for us, and now it highlights that why it is important to understand elephant and their ecology to do something for their conservation. So whenever we talk about conservation of elephants or any target species, if you see the current ratio of study or type of study they do, so most of the study will be either in population structure, habitat suitability, how behavior is changing with changing in habitat, and so on and so forth. But what I see is lacking in such kind of science is physiological understanding. So we lack the understanding that how such changes in habitat or how changes in suitable habitat or structure, population structure, is changing the physiological state of elephant is not known. So this part of science which deals with understanding the physiological aspect of any animal is called conservation physiology, and my research mainly focuses on conservation physiology. With this, I would like to explain about my ongoing work. Till here, I just explained about the basic biology about elephant. And if you guys have any questions, you can just type in a chat box or you can post, I can answer it later. So why I felt like studying the stress response? Well, when I came to India for the first time to do my PhD, particularly in context of Indian Institute of Science, we are supposed to design our own question. So when I joined Professor Raman Sukumar lab, I thought, you know, at first I thought that I'll study about elephant-plant interaction. However, when I came to India and I saw there are lots of news circulating in media about adverse elephant-human interaction, that is elephant being killed by humans, elephant coming out of the habitat and attacking humans in return, elephant being killed in electrocution, elephant being killed in railway collision, so on and so forth. So there was more adverse news circulating over Indian media and also international media. So this is what motivated me, and the reason behind such kind of adverse elephant-human conflict is quite obvious. You know, in India there are around 28,000 to 30,000 wild Asian elephants, which is around 50 to 60% of global Asian elephant population. However, the protected areas in India forms only 22% of elephant habitat. That means most of the elephants are either in human-dominated landscape, reserve forest, or somewhere in, you know, fragmented pockets of forest. And this is where there is sharing of resources between two powerful species, elephant and human. When two powerful species share same resources, of course, there will be rise in adverse human-elephant conflict, or sorry, interaction. So if you, I'd like to make a note here. I have avoided deliberately to use term human-elephant conflict and have replaced it with adverse human-elephant interaction. So whenever I say adverse human-elephant interaction, it is human-elephant conflict. So as a result, in India, every year, 500 humans get killed by elephant and 100 elephants are killed in retaliation by human. So such is the situation. It's the escalating rate of adverse human-elephant interaction. And when I saw this, I wanted to know that how such situation is influencing the health of elephant. And this is where I thought that rather than understanding the interaction between plant and animal, I'll just go ahead and study the stress physiology in elephant. So stress physiology, I just would like to briefly explain it here, and it's I won't go into technicality of it, though I may explain some of the pathway. So when we talk about space physiology, it's a quite common and a very basic concept. We do know that in our surrounding, there are lots of tension or, you know, disturbances, you, whatever you can call it, perturbation, challenges, and our body perceives those challenges, and there's something called homeostasis. Homeostasis is the body balancing mechanism. It gets disrupted. So when the body balance gets disrupted, our body reacts to such kind of challenges. That reaction is called stress response. So a stress response can be physiological, it can be psychological response, it can be social or behavioral responses. But my interest particularly was to understand the physiological response. So here I introduce some of the technical aspect. I'll not go into the detail, but I'll just give you just brief idea so that, you know, it will be important for you to understand what exactly goes inside elephant head when they face any kind of disturbances. So here, as I said, there are lots of stressors. So the challenges are also called stressors. This is perceived by something called hypothalamus pituitary adrenal axis. So I'll not go into the detail again, but this axis gets activated, and the byproduct or the ultimate product released by this axis is called glucocorticoids, which is also known as cortisol. So if you can see it here. So glucocorticoids are generally termed as stress hormone. However, we should also keep in mind that glucocorticoids are not just a stress hormone. It has multiple functions. One of the functions is in stress. So when glucocorticoid gets released in blood, it has negative feedback loop and this cycle stops. This is the situation when there is less stress. Imagine there is you see a tiger somewhere and you run away. And then you realize that tiger is long gone, so you'll get relaxed after some time. That is a situation. That kind of stress is called acute stress. But imagine that you are facing some kind of stress for a prolonged period. In our case, imagine elephants are facing obstruction due to airport or something, formation of airport or something like that. In that case, elephants are facing such kind of problem for a prolonged period. In such cases, this negative feedback loop gets disrupted and body keeps on generating glucocorticoids. Now this glucocorticoid, which was actually helping animal to run away from the problem, will start disturbing the homeostasis. What it does is it affects the immunity, it affects the cognitive ability of animal and also the reproduction of elephants. And finally, it threatens the survival of elephants. So this is where it is important to understand glucocorticoids. And so what I did was I thought of studying this. And however, when you see glucocorticoid, we have to assess the glucocorticoid or to monitor the glucocorticoid, you have to collect blood sample. But in this case, I was a bit reluctant because I was strictly against, you know, going and collecting blood sample from elephant because it's not ethical. Second point is collecting a blood sample from wild elephant is highly dangerous. Third thing is there are ways of collecting blood sample from elephants, like you can capture, restrain and handle. But however, in this situation, there is lots of handling required. When there is handling of elephants, that means we are creating stress to that animal, which will bias our experiment. That is where I thought of studying fecal glucocorticoid metabolite. So what happens is this metabolite undergoes many, this hormone undergoes many kinds of metabolism and conjugation, and finally gets secreted out or excreted out in the form of metabolites. So this is what I measured in elephants. For this, what I did was I studied mostly for my PhD. I extensively worked in the forest of Karnataka, Bandipur, Nagarhole, as an intact forest, and I studied in Kodagu and Hasan, which is highly you can say it, like it's a human dominated landscape with elephants and mosaic of agricultural land. And for my ongoing research, I'm working in South and West Bengal, the Northwest Bengal, because these are the sites where there are high human disturbances. So what exactly I do in the forest is I follow the elephants. Once I follow elephant, I identify each of these individuals and I mark their S class. In case of Asian elephants, there are 4 S class, adult, subadult, juvenile, and calf. And once the elephant defecate and move away, I collect the sample and then immediately store it in icebox. But like I said earlier, that you know, I avoided collecting blood sample and thought of collecting fecal sample. But when I was in forest, I realized that it is not as easy as to collect the fecal sample as I was thinking for collecting blood sample. So it was really dangerous because I had to follow elephants, observe them, hide behind the bush. And you should also realize that I was in the area where there were around 1,000 elephants. It's an elephant habitat, so it was really risky job. So once I collected this fecal sample, I brought them into lab, and I do extraction and analysis. For analysis, I use ELISA technique. Whoever in the crowd, whoever is listening to me right now, if you guys are really interested into getting into the detail of how to analyze the stress hormone, I'll be more than happy to talk to you. You can write to me. I won't explain the detail right now in the presentation. So since, as I said, that collecting a fecal sample was quite a risky job for me, so what I did was, and this sample should be very fresh. It should be like the window should be around 3 hours to 6 hours max. And this is, and what I did was, I did not just measure the hormone. I also measured age class of elephants. I measured the diet of elephants, and also the identify the sex of the individual using these fecal samples. So that's where I thought of being clever and using my effort of collecting dung sample. So with this, I'll just in detail, I won't go into the detail. I'll just give you the brief snapshot of the findings. And again, like I said earlier, whoever is interested regarding my stress hormone work, please kindly contact me. I'll forward all these papers to you. So one of the finding was, I found that resources availability could directly affect the body condition of elephants. I developed this chart for wild elephants, and I also found that it is quite related with stress hormone. With increase in body condition, the hormone level was going down. And another finding was that I found the presence of calves, less adult female lactation would increase the stress level in adult females. And one of the interesting finding that I find myself interesting was the lower level of stress in elephants, which were crop raiders. So like all of you guys, whoever is listening to me must have thought, you know, elephant which is crop raiding will face more human threat, and thus they will have more stress level. However, in my finding, what I found that they had a lower level of glucocorticoid as compared to the elephant inside the forest, which were not raiding crops. It was kind of paradigm shift for me, and I could have stopped my research there. But what I did was, I went ahead and quantitated the quality of diet, and I found that elephants which were raiding crops or foraging on crops, they had a good level of proteins and other nutrients, and that's the reason the stress level was lower. So with this, I found that the stress elephant have multiple factors that influence their stress physiology, and these elephants which are stressed will definitely behave differently. And out of and as per my ongoing research, I'm trying to understand the how human disturbance, level of human disturbance, could influence the stress level in elephants. And this is now I realized, you know, after doing all this almost 9 years of research, I realized that whatever finding I have found is just a drop in a vast ocean. There is more to explore in the field of stress physiology, and whoever is listening to me is much, you know, invited to join my league to understand the stress response in elephant. With this, I'd also like to present take you through one of our research, which I'm collaborating with Dr. Nachiket, who is actually focusing on Asian elephant thanatology research in India, and also working on elephant vocalization. So the term thanatology is a reaction to death of their conspecific, or can be to heterospecific. So in this research, what we did was, we documented the reaction towards their relatives, or death of their relatives, or death conspecific or other elephants, may not be related to them. So why I'm sharing this, all this research to you, why I'm talking about stress response, and why I'm talking about thanatology, is I want to make you guys realize that elephants are highly sensitive when we talk about behavior or physiology, and when we talk about emotions, that means they can sense what is happening in their environment. So this information can be very useful when we understand about Nizhgarh Airport, or when we understand about the influence of any mega development project. So please keep this information in your mind when I'm going through other slides. So this paper is published, and when so whoever is interested, I can forward this again to you guys. So with this, I have briefly touched upon the biology of elephants. I have talked about the stress response in elephant and also the thanatological reaction in elephants. Now I would like to discuss about the movement, why movement is important in elephant. Like I said in the earlier slide, in case of elephant, they are a group living individual. They are highly social. So when they are highly social, they need to communicate with each other. They need to move from one path to another. And when, like I said, in the social organization aspect of elephants, that they keep on choosing together and dispersing. That means movement is a vital part of their general behavior. And in addition, they are large body animal. They have large home range. The home range may range from 20 kilometers to several thousand kilometers, depending on habitat size, resource availability, and also the population size of elephant. And they travel extensively to meet food and habitat requirement. So in case of elephant, they move seasonally and sometimes opportunistically to, like I already said, that to move to meet the reproductive, sometimes nutritional need, and also the space need. And sometimes they also move to avoid any stochastic event like drought, flooding, or some natural calamity happens in their habitat, then they move from one patch to another patches. So the ultimate goal of movement in elephant helps elephant in survival and fitness. When I talk about fitness, it's a reproductive fitness, and also helps in facilitating the regular genetic exchange between these elephants. So the ultimate, the ultimate output of this movement will support the long-term viable population. So keep in mind that movement is very vital part of elephants, that it helps not only in providing the food or habitat requirement, but also in supporting the viable population. This is when they are in natural condition. Now let us imagine their habitat is highly fragmented. There are lots of hurdles in front of them. So studies have proven that, elephant movement depends on the risk they face. If there is less risk, right, in case of forested area, they move relaxedly. But if they are in human disturbance site or fragmented site, they prefer areas which has comparatively or relatively low human activities. So and they are cleverly allocating time and time, residence, and also speed of movement depending on the disturbances or hurdles they face during their movement. Like in case of time, when they are in fragmented habitat, they prefer night. They prefer nighttime to move, so that daytime there will be more human activities. They avoid it. In case of residence, they will halt in an area which is highly disturbed for a shorter period, or they'll just take a refuge and they'll just leave during the nighttime. And talking about the speed, when they are in fragmented patches or highly disturbed patches, it's striking behavior in a sense. They move very rapidly, with a rapid pace, not unlike when they are in forested area. And one of the study also showed that all these activities, behavior like striking behavior, punching behavior, was also associated with higher stress hormone, suggesting that they are highly stressed when they are in such habitat. So this is where the term corridors or connectivity comes handy. Whenever we talk about elephants in fragmented habitat, we talk about connectivity. But connectivity, and many people I have seen that they use the term corridor very loosely. They define anything, any path elephant walk from one patch to another patch, they'll call it corridor. However, there is, like I said, there is ambiguity in definition of corridor. There is a general definition of corridor, which is a linear landscape that connects two habitat. So imagine there is two source habitat A and habitat B. Both of the habitat has viable population. So in this area, the main function of, and these areas are separated by the hurdles. It can be human settlement, it can be agricultural landscape or activities, it can be ecological barrier like mountains, and it can be, in our context, developmental project. So in such situation, the main function of corridor is to provide the accelerated movement. So you can see that elephant will use this patch to the linear landscape to move from one patch to another patch. And this patch may have the vegetation which is quite similar to habitat A or habitat B. So this is what we define as corridor, and the main motto of corridor is to help in nutritional, to help elephants to gain the nutritional need to for facilitating the survival shift, and on the top to maintain the genetic exchange. So how we can define corridors? Many times we get confused that random path, we may call it as corridor. So you can, you know, the corridor can be defined based on their functionality and also structure. When I say functionality, how often elephant is using it, whether elephant is using that path at all or not. So that is where we need to be very careful about defining corridors. So based on the functionality of corridor and also the structure of corridor, there are various kind of corridors. There is something called standard corridors. There is two habitat patch, and there is this kind of corridor which link these two habitat, then it's called standard corridor. There's another kind of corridor where the level of severance is quite different. If you can see here, this corridor is quite bigger than this one. So mostly elephant will prefer this corridor. However, some of the bulls may use such small corridors to move from one pass to another pass. But we need to realize that elephants are using such kind of corridor. So, you know, are using such kind of linear connectivity element, and thus we need to call this as also as a corridor. In other cases, you can see there are multiple pathways that elephant make, and they are all using these pathways. These pathways should be called as corridor and need conservation. And something called foothill corridor. Foothill corridor, I think in context of Parsa and Bagmati corridor, I don't know whether we can call it as a foothill corridor, but it can be quite, you know, related to Nepal. There are two habitats, and there is hill on the other side, and there is human settlement or other disturbances. In such cases, elephant use the foothill of the hills to move from one pass to another pass. Such kind of corridor is called foothill corridors. And there is stepping stone corridor. Stepping stone corridor is, we have two mega habitats, the source habitat where there are viable population, and there are pockets of forest which elephant use from, you know, traveling from one place to another patch. So many times people get confused that, you know, this pocket of forest could be a habitat. However, we should also realize that such patches will not support the viable population, and in ecological terms they are called sink habitat or sink, where elephant will stay for a temporary basis and then again they will move ahead. And in another context, there are something called fragmented forest corridor, where the habitats are highly fragmented and there are pockets of forest that actually link, and elephant use such for movement. One of the fascinating corridor that I personally appreciate is the community corridor, where the two habitats are again separated by the barrier of human settlement, but the community actually develop a community forest in between this patch so that elephant can move freely. So these are the types of corridor, and all these corridors, depending on the uses by elephants, should be conserved. So here I would like to take example from our neighboring country, India. And since I'm working here, I find this study very fascinating, the Rite of Passage by Menon in 2017. They also studied in 2005. So India in general has five population. As I said earlier, there are 27,000 to 30,000 elephants in India. And there are five population of elephants: southern population, north eastern population, northwest Bengal population, central population, northwestern population. And this study, the Rite of Passage study, what they did was they demarcated the corridors. They scientifically studied all the corridors based on the structure and functionality. And they found that there is more fragmentation, there is less forest cover, and there's more rise in corridors. So they found that there are 88 elephant corridors. There was 88 elephant corridors in, there were 88 elephant corridors in 2005, but it has increased to 101 elephant corridors in 2017. Some of the corridors in 2005 are no more functional because elephants are not using them at all. However, as I said, that there is increase in fragmentation, so there is increase in number of corridors. And interestingly, what they also did was, you know, Indian Wildlife Protection Act, what they have done is they have marked these areas as ecologically sensitive area. So this is very interesting that all these corridors are now protected. And the model they use to define corridor, I think Nepal should also follow similar kind of model. There is nothing wrong to, you know, follow the good example. So in this case, what they did was they used public initiative model to demarcate and to identify corridors. Where they involve public and local communities. In government settlement, wherever government has hold of land, they use those power to secure the corridors. And in many cases, they also purchase the private land to make corridors and also involved community to maintain such kind of corridors. They have created something called Green Corridor Champions, which actually have an eye on and maintain such kind of corridor. So this is a very good example that one should learn in the context when there is rapid fragmentation and habitat loss in context of elephants. So now let us come back to Nepal. So in context of Nepal, elephants are considered as protected species under our Wildlife Protection Act. And there are also the habitat of elephants is well protected under the Elephant Conservation Action Plan, the Terai Arc Landscape. So if you see the historical distribution of elephants, elephants were distributed all through the foothills of Churai and also the Terai area. However, like in many elephant ranging country, Nepal is also no away from, you know, fragmentation, urbanization, rapid settlement of humans and infrastructure development, which has resulted in pocket of forest. So we have four population of elephants, which is eastern population ranging, which includes Kosi Tapu and the neighboring areas. Central population, western population, and far western population. So I'm assuming that whoever is listening to me, you know, you guys know about this, that we have four population of elephants in Nepal. And the total population, they say, is around 100 to 150. But some of the reports also suggest there are around 180 to 220 elephants. The variation in population's number could be because most of the elephants are migratory. They are traveling from India to Nepal. So, you know, sometime such variation may come into existence. Now, talking about the conflict situation or the interaction, how these elephants are placed or the condition of elephants in Nepal. In the eastern population, most of the elephants are migratory. So they freely move towards, they actually are linked towards the north West Bengal area. And it's free movement. And there is lots of anthropogenic activities in this area. So consequently, there is rise in human-elephant adverse interaction. And similarly, in case of central population, the areas is quite intact. The forests are very intact. The Chitwan, Parsa, and even Nizgard, all this area provides an intact forest and also provide a fantastic opportunity for elephants, for the resources, water resources, and forest resources. There is less migration between this population, except there is a Valmiki area here. However, there is less movement here. And thus, the elephant mostly are resident here. And in case of western population, this population is linked with Katania Ghat and Dudhwa. So elephants are moving in between our population to in adjoining areas of India. And many times you can see that, you know, bulls, the solitary bulls have induced interaction with humans, which may have resulted in adverse elephant-human interactions. In case of far western, the population here is a part of 1500 elephants in adjoining forest of India, and thus there is a seasonal movement here. So there is less interaction between humans and elephant in this patch. So as a result, one of the study by Dinesh, he reported that there are around, you know, 50 humans dead and 13 elephants dead in just the year 2003 and 2012 in eastern population. There was 41 human death in central population. It is quite surprising. And in case of western population, you can see that there is considerable, you know, both elephant and human mortality. So with this, I have given you the brief idea about how the context of elephant is in case of Nepal, and also give you the idea about corridor and what corridors are called. So now I would like to talk about how elephant react to rapidly changing ecological context or disturbances. This is in this slide. I would like to illustrate some of the studies that has been done on wild Asian elephants, and mostly on wild Asian elephants, and how they react to such some kind of disturbances or not. So like I may have missed this point, that elephant have an excellent learning capacity because they have complex cognitive abilities. So because of that, they can alter and sometimes adjust to some kind of or some level of disturbances. So one of the study by Dr. Nachiket from Indian Institute of Science, he showed that elephants are actually modulating their vocalization or calls when they perceive disturbances, the disturbances which includes not just human disturbances but other forms of disturbances also. So they are actually modulating their calls when they perceive disturbance. Another study, they showed that that the elephants are actually increasing their vigilance. They are avoiding the disturbed site and preferring a resource rich site when these elephants were in fragmented habitat. And the same study group showed fantastic findings that there is a striking emergent behavior in elephants, that they are forming male groups. This is really interesting. Like I said earlier, that male elephants are generally solitary. They form bachelor groups seasonally inside the forest, but those are unstable group. But this study group found that they are actually forming a stable male group when they are in human dominated landscape. So this is really interesting that they are altering their behavior. So one of my finding, which is in preparation, I found that elephants are highly stressed when they are in high disturbance area. And another study, again in Nepal, by Purushottam Sharma, he found that elephants prefer a habitat which is away from roads, and they avoid human settlement. So, and this study, the one I'm presenting now, is on the African elephants. In African elephants, they found that elephants show streaking behavior. They bunch together. They take refuse behavior. The refuse behavior is nothing but elephants tend to hide during the daytime, and at the nighttime they are active. So they hide in areas in plantation, coffee plantation areas, and again come out to forage on agricultural crops. Such behavior, such areas, such things are called the refuse behavior, and also they found that this is associated with high stress hormones. So all these findings suggest that elephants are actually altering their behavior. They're trying to adjust with disturbances. They're altering their behavior, they're altering their movement to adjust with habitat loss or any kind of developmental project or obstruction due to developmental project disturbances or fragmentation. This could be a short-term adaptive strategy. But we should also keep in mind that when they are altering their behavior, how this alteration, how this modification is influencing the physiological health of elephant, how it is, threatening the fitness and survival of Asian elephants is still not studied. So now, since we are talking, so the presentation started with Salonika and Sagarika introducing about Nizgarh. So here again, I want to cite one example from our neighboring country. This time it is not India, it's China. So in China, we have 300 elephants. What China did was, there is a river called Mekong. So they plan to build a dam in the Mekong River. So they started this project with a proposal in 2003, and they did EIA project, EIA report, and in the EIA report it was stated that there is no influence of this dam on elephant population. So finally this project got sanctioned and it came into operation. So however, the elephants which were isolated due to this kind of dam learn to adjust with the rising level of water. They try to adapt with the rising level of water. Like I said in before slide, that they can alter their behavior. They learn to adapt to the behavior. But we do not know till what extent they can do it. And we do not know that how, what level of disturbance they can adjust to. Slowly what happened was their habitat was restricted. There was no movement. So these elephants, like the actual number was around 18, and these elephants started having adverse interaction with humans. So from 2011 to 2019, there were 77 human deaths and also injury due to elephants. So, and they lost around, you know, $3 million crop damage was happened due to this just 18 elephants. So now they realize that they have done the mistake that, you know, building up a dam was not a good idea. And they are coming up with a recommendation that we need to build a corridor. So this can be one fantastic example right now when we talk about the mega project that we are planning to do. So again, finally, coming back to the issue, and here I won't take much time. I think I have hardly two or three slides, and I'd love to discuss with you guys. And so talking about NISGERD, being an ecologist and particularly elephant biologist, I consider NISGERD as an extension corridor. It's a fantastic extension corridor which provides fantastic habitat, not just for elephant, also for other small mammals adjoining Chitwan, Parsa, and also, you know, linking between central population and eastern population. Now, keep this information aside. I would like to congratulate Nepal, because Nepal is coming up with one of the fantastic mega project of building up fourth largest deer hub in Nepal. Like most of the leaders and many people who are supporting it call it a possible game changer. I don't deny in this fact that it could actually change the game, you know. It is a possible what we can call treasure for the employment generation and opportunity. However, we should also keep in mind, and you know, many people may think that that why we are against it. Nobody will want to see, or nobody, you know, everyone being a, we being a Nepalese citizen, we actually want to see Nepal shining bright in the horizon of economy, but at the cost of what? So this should be very clear to us. So in this context, when we say that, you know, this possible, this mega project could be a possible game changer of Nepal, providing lots of employment opportunities and, you know, being a model for many people. But we should also realize that it is hurting our sentiment, because we are ecologists, and it hurts the ecology sentiment, because they are mostly because they are not considering their wrong choice of site selection and the plan they have for the activities of cutting down the trees and all this aspect. You know, that hurts our sentiment. We are not against the development of project or airport or in Nepal. However, the site selection, I feel personally, site selection and the activities that is planned is strictly against ecology. Since I would not go into the detail about how many billions project it is, how many hectares of land it is going to clear, they are going to clear, and how many trees they are going to cut down, because by now most of the Nepalese citizens know each and every details. So I won't highlight that. And just I want to talk about the expected consequences, so you know, potential consequences of these trees being this forest being cleared down, what it may, how it may influence the ecological aspect and so on. And even for this, I'm pretty sure that most of you guys are already aware about such kind of impact. You know, it may have ecological impact. We may lose native hardwood forest. And there are many taxa which we may not have studied, you know, that there's loss of that knowledge, there is damage to biodiversity, hindrances to animal mobility, particularly mega animal like elephants, psychophysiological influence on animals, not just on elephants, other mammals as well, and accelerated human wildlife adverse interactions. So all these aspects are quite clear to us by now. Similarly, it may have environmental impact. You know, there may be depletion of groundwater, disruption of biogeochemical cycle, flooding, rapid reduction in carbon sequestration, pollution, rapid expansion of urban areas, health hazard, calamities. When I'm narrating all these things, I feel like, you know, we are building up some kind of horror movie in Nepal. So I feel like, you know, but all this thing is quite clear to, not to us, but also to authorities who are in the panel and who have decided to go ahead with the project. And also the social, cultural, economic impact, which, you know, sometimes is highly ignored. So when we are going to relocate this native population, whoever are going to whoever was residing there, and then there is So when we have an airport, there will be lots of migrants from different places, maybe from different countries as well. So this may threaten the native culture and tradition. So these are some of the aspects which actually, you know, frightens us. It's kind of a nightmare for all the ecologists. On the top, what made me, you know, feel more horrible was the reforestation scheme or the solution that was given. They said that, please correct me, I don't know whether I'm right with the facts or not. They said that for every one tree, they are going to replace 5 trees. Here, I feel that it is ecologically unrealistic, and also it's a complete disregard to the ecological processes. You know, we are ignoring the ecological processes we took 1,000 years to establish, like ecological services, the forest, the succession that happens, the phenomena, the cycles that goes on by geochemical cycle. We are completely ignoring it. So, you know, this should be kept in mind. This should be kept in mind when we go ahead with such kind of mega project. Today I'm talking about elephants. So I thought that, you know, I should also highlight that how this such kind of mega project could influence the elephant biology or ecology in that case. So we already discussed, such kind of project may have a restricted movement. You know, they may restrict the movement. When there is restriction of movement, the social group get disrupted. I already highlighted that elephant have a very intact social grouping. They tend to move. There is again fluid movement that they tend to come together and disperse. So there will be disruption in such kind of social structure. And since elephant have multiple role in ecosystem, this ecosystem health can get distorted. And there will be increased instances of elephant interaction with humans. And I'm pretty sure the interaction will not be positive. It will be negative. And due to which, you know, it may lead to accidental mortality of elephants as well as humans. And on the top of all this chaos and confusion, there will be psychological, physiological influences in elephant, which we are going to ignore, because we can't see it through our eyes, but it is happening inside elephant. And hence, elephant will alter their normal behavior. So when they start altering their normal behavior, this means they will reduce their survival and fitness. You know, such kind of, all these are so very cyclic. And ultimately, we are putting all this viable population into questions, and also this restricted movement and all this stuff will hinder the genetic exchange. So when I was reading about Nizgard, you know, most of the research articles, whatever is coming out from Nepal, they only highlighted the problems. Most of the articles, there are few articles which have highlighted the solution as well, but most of the articles are only highlighting the problems, that what possible problems it can create, the ecological impact, environmental impact, the socioeconomic and all this aspect. Like in my case, I highlighted the impact to elephant biology. But I think we should also try to look for the alternative, because all of us are rational citizens of Nepal, and hence, and also very educated, and we have lots of ideas in our mind. We should come up with the alternative ideas. And I was also a little surprised that there is something called TAL strategic plan 2015-2025. This is readily available online. Whoever's interested, please take it and read, download it and read. This study has clearly mentioned, they have clearly predicted that the large infrastructure in Tarai will have a negative influence. They have actually done the calculation and they have said that it has negative impact on large mammals. It will have negative impact on Churai forest. It will have negative impact on Tarai ecosystem. So I feel that why this project, this report was ignored. So coming about the alternatives, I also, when I was researching about this, I found that there are alternative sites that people are proposing for again, other than Nizgarh, like Gautam Buddha, and there's one place in Sarlahi. Why those areas are not spoken about? Because these areas may have lesser ecological influence on the animals and other ecosystem. They may have a pollution, and all this aspect may, all the project will have, but they will have in terms of relativity, it will be quite lesser. And you know, even talking about connectivity, why Nepal is not creatively thinking about connectivity, and you know, how to develop all this thing, why corridors are not studied. So this is where I think all the youth, whoever is studying wildlife science, should come forth. And I think, you know, rather than making it a fourth largest largest air hub, Nepal should target to make a model airport in a such a way that, you know, they have to build some ecologically friendly airport so that many people will travel all over the world to just to see the airport. You know, something of that sort, I think they should consider such kind of point. Well, this is one of the picture that I drew for one of my opinion that I wrote on online. So if you see that most of the people who are talking about the Nizhgarh, against and for the Nizhgarh, everyone knows that it is going to have a huge impact on ecology. And people are also considering about economic benefit they may get. So the most of the voices that we raise for the ecology is quite less, I think, and economic viability is winning the game. So with this, the rest is in your hand, and you know, we should, like I said, that we should suggest some alternative plan, and let's hope that we will come through some solid solution for this problem. With this, I would like to end, and would like to receive any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Sankita, for your wonderful presentation. Like you said that the Nizhgarh Airport is supposed to be built in 8,000 hectares of land and of forest, and the area that is supposed to be used is a very significant area for elephants and for reproduction, because every year the elephants in the Borsa National Park, they interbreed with elephants from Sunsari and Sindhuli. So what do you think would be the significance of this of this airport in the elephant survival and survival, reproduction and everything?
Yeah, so like I mentioned in one of the slides, I gave the potential, you know, influence of such kind of activities on elephant ecology. So I said that if imagine in the elephant route or in the elephant linear landscape where elephants are traveling from one patch to another patch, and there is a big hurdle or hindrances. So initially, you know, elephant may learn, try to adjust with such kind of hindrances. They may find alternative route, but in somehow they may, you know, such kind of alteration may change. They may change their behavior. So when they are changing their behavior, this kind of aspect, like I have already said, may disrupt the social organization of elephants, and also, you know, create physiological, psychological changes, behavioral changes, which may in long term have influence on the overall ecology and survival of elephants. So yeah, that's what I think I presented that in the presentation slide as well.
Thank you. Now we're taking some more questions.
All right.
So do you think that the elephants could leave, could they leave and find new route in the area, or like I've heard some argue that because of the noise coming from the airport and because of the people's movement there, that the elephants would just go back to Borsa National Park. And do you think is that more probable of happening, or would they find a new route, or is the negative human elephant interaction more probable?
So see, since right now I think we can just assume, because nobody has studied the influence of such mega disturbances, that how elephant can deal with such kind of disturbances. So based on our understanding and assumption, I think that initially they may try to learn, like I said earlier, that they may try to find out the alternative way, or like people suggest that they go back in Borsa, but however they need to move. So ecologically, movement is a crucial part of elephant science. So they will be moving from one patch to another patch. So I think it will have a direct influence on their movement, and hence, you know, this, like in case of China, we studied. I just showed the example about China, that how it is creating more. So such kind of disturbance may change psychological and physiological aspect, and elephant may become more aggressive when there are lots of noises, lots of human crowd. So you know, there may be interaction, increasing instances of humans and elephant. Yeah. So yeah, I think that will be a negative impact, that they will learn initially, but how so, but we nobody studied that, how this mega project could influence the ecology of or the behavior of elephants. We can just assume and predict that, you know, they may learn for certain period, but ultimately it will give a big question mark to their survival and fitness.
Okay, so there's a very technical question regarding Nizhgard Airport. So I'll just read the question. Elephant corridors in the proposed site is hindered by the main physical infrastructure of the Nizhgard Airport or only certain part of the airport, such as hangar or runway. How likely are the elephants to change their behavior and adapt the environment change after the airport is built? I believe elephants are quite good in adapting.
Can you repeat the question?
Okay.
The
main question is that are the elephants hindered by the entire Nizhgard Airport or only certain parts of the airport? And how likely are the elephants to change their behavior and adapt to environments change after the airport is built? And like you said, they are avoiding roads and human settlements and can survive in greatly diversified ecosystem. How likely is the chance for Nizhgard Airport to? How about the development of underground or overhead crossings at some area of the Nizhgard Airport to help them keep using their corridor in causing less impact?
That's a fantastic question. Whoever posted it, I would like to thank you. So now we need to understand, you know, the types of disturbances. So when I said that elephant can can alter the behavior depending on the disturbances, we should keep in mind that what kind of disturbances it is. So imagine in case of dam, or imagine in case of, you know, large road or breeze that is obstructing the movement. In such cases, elephant will learn and may learn. So I'm just assuming, this is my assumption, this is my perception. So they may learn how to cross the bridge, they may learn how to change the route, and so on and so forth. In this case, we are talking about airport. And when we are talking about airport, it's not just a large block that is on your route. There is also flight coming and going. There is sound disturbances, a set of sound. And like I said, that elephants are very sensitive towards sound and any kind of sudden movement. The sound here, and there's like more people are going to come. So there are lots of traffic going on. And I'm just assuming the things that may happen. And there will be settlement, increment in settlement. Now, so for a certain period, they may learn to alter, but it will be a short-term alteration. There will be a short period, they may move from one place to another. But if things are happening in such larger scale, there is multiple, it's not just one, the synergistic effect of multiple type of disturbances coming together. So how elephants are going to learn that, it is a big question. So I really don't think that, you know, it will be like they can adapt to such kind of changes. I feel that, and another cycle that it will be really hard to adapt to such kind of last changes.
And do you think that the...
But that was a very valid question.
Yes, thank you for the question. Mm-hmm. And do you think that elephants might be destructive mm-hmm. to the airport? As in, like, as you know, that in the Driven International Airport, there are disturbances caused by birds, and there are 4 people hired just to manage the bird population. So do you think that elephants also can also damage the airport and sites it anyways?
Awesome. Amazing. So considering that how elephant could be dangerous, I really thank whoever posted this question. And you know, when it is one point, so here the power of airport is more, I think, than elephant. But when that building is going to be 4 buses for the bird, I think they will also have trenches and fences to prevent elephant or any other animal coming in. So I don't think elephant will be a problem for any suspect. And you know what, elephant deliberately will not disturb any project or any humans in that case. They never do that. Elephants love to be in their own. They avoid humans, like I said earlier. They avoid humans, they avoid disturbances. So,
Thank you. And we have some more questions regarding elephants. I think, like, Regarding Asian and African elephants, like which are more aggressive? Yeah.
Well, the level of aggression entirely depends on the habitat. Sometimes, you know, elephants inside the forest, if you see, when we go inside the forest, and like in my case, when I work inside the forest of Karnataka, elephants are, so it's very relative term. So it is like idiosyncratic and population level differences, I'd call it. So many elephants, the aggression depends entirely on the level of disturbances, the level of physiological state they are in. If elephants are in mass, they'll be more aggressive. And even if you see, you know, in case of Asian, in African elephants also, sometimes the videos virals that elephant attacking humans and all thing. But it entirely depends on the risk they are facing. If there is more intrusion by humans and more physiological changes that is happening, and if there is must and other aspect that I think elephants will be more aggressive. It's a very subjective question.
And also regarding African elephants, so what is the possible cause for the death of more than 300 elephants in Africa a week before?
Yeah. Wonderful. Yeah. So see, even I shared this news about Botswana, where elephants, more than 300 elephants died. So they ruled out the possibility of poaching. They said that it's not poaching, it's not poisoning, because all the tusk and everything was intact. And they, I myself assume that could be some possible reason of genotic causes that they might have died some because of some like anthrax. When the elephants or any animal die due to anthrax, there will be bleeding in the mouth and genital areas and all this thing. So there was no such thing. So I think they were doing research on it. They were trying to find it out. I mean, still, but as far as scientists, as far as my science, as far as my understanding is concerned, I think it's. Yes, Salonika.
Okay, sorry. Yeah, so one more question is, during the mating season, like, do the male elephants fight with each other for mating with a female, or do they leave some kind of a scent or something?
Oh, wonderful. So this question, this is chemical signaling thing that I said, I said that they secrete temporarine hormone. Temporarine pheromone is actually, you know, used for signaling females and also the males that this male is in sexually active phase. And other than, so you said that fighting is tough. So male and male, they do combat not for gaining the females. So there is one of the research that was done from our lab. What they did was, they compared elephants' body size and also the role of tusk. They said that the tusk could be, you know, their initial hypothesis was whether the tusk is used as ornament for attracting females or not. And they found that it's not the tusk, but the secretion of temporal gland, the condition called musk, that actually attracts female than the tusk. And also the body size. Imagine there are two elephants, which is lesser in body size, and there is one elephant bigger in body size. Female tends to go towards the male, which is larger in body size. Imagine there are two elephants, both of same body size, but one elephant is in musk and secreting temporal gland secretion. Then elephant tend to move towards the elephant, which is in musk. So such kind of combinations is there.
Thank you. So there's a comment and question.
Yeah.
Thank you for your wonderful presentation. My question is pointed out that crop raiding elephant low level of fecal glucocorticoid level than elephants living in core area of forest. Could you explain cause behind it? Why elephants form male group?
Oh,
okay. And this
why elephant form male group?
Yeah, this behavior is also observed in rhesus monkeys. So yeah.
Oh, wonderful. So talking about the low level of stress hormone, so when I started that work, like all of you guys, I had a hypothesis that elephants which are raiding, if I can put that your word, foraging on agricultural crops, I hypothesized that elephant will have more level of stress. That was my initial hypothesis. Because elephant, when they forage on agricultural crop, they get loss of their, exposed to human disturbances, they're exposed to human induced threat. So my obvious hypothesis was level will be high. And when I measured the study, when I fecal glucocorticoid metabolites, I found the fecal glucocorticoid metabolite was lesser in crop-raiding elephant than the elephants which were in the intact forest, particularly for my study population. So here you keep that, you know, this may vary depending on the disturbance, human disturbance. So what I did was, why it could be the lesser hormone level, so I could have stopped research there and say that, oh, I found that the level is low, I could have assumed something. So what I did was, I went ahead and measured the diet quality in elephants for the tongue sample. And I found the elephants which were crop raiding had higher level of protein as compared to elephants which were ready crops. And in addition, what I did was, you know, initially I did the habitat quality study. So the habitat, the crop raiders, the elephants which were in the crop raiding site or human dominated landscape, they have higher level of NDVI. Elephants which had habitats where elephants were not raiding or inside the forest, they have lesser NDVI. But when we use NDVI, we should be very careful that most of the time NDVI doesn't necessarily represent the type of forest elephant are eating. You know, it could be just a greenery, it's just an index of greenery. So that's to cross-validate my finding. NDVI is higher in crop raiding area than in areas which where elephants are not raiding. I measured the diet quality and protein was high. And now, since you were, so one of the principle of stress hormone is, if you are having good access to diet or the diet quality is good, the stress hormone goes down. It's a way of, you know, pacifying your stress hormone. It could be one of the reasons. That's what I have written in that paper. Now, talking about a male-male formation, group formation. So in this case, most of the time, the bachelor group that they form is to, you know, learn this kind of social learning from each individual, learn how to raid, go out of the forest, raid crops, and they come back. So such kind of bachelor group has been explained in some of the findings of Professor Raman Sukumar. But in this case, when in human habitation, they are forming the stable group. First thing is to, you know, avoid any kind of human disturbances and also to learn about the resources that are allocated in different places. So it's kind of social learning and also assurance to maintain, you know, kind of security, sense of security for those animals. So it's an emergent behavior in elephants, quite interesting. Thank you.
Hello, could you hear me?
Sorry, so Mr. Keshav Bhattrai wants to talk once. Can you try unmuting your mic once? I'll try something on the settings.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, sure.
Oh, sorry, Sanjita ji, can you're muted? Can you try unmuting yourself? Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry.
All right.
So his question is: what decibel level could be harmful to elephant reproduction because big airplanes generate loud noise?
What is that? Can you repeat the first part?
What decibel level could be harmful to elephant reproduction because big airplanes generate loud noise?
Oh, so the exact number I do not know, but yeah, so and nobody has studied that how the sonic boom or how the sound waves can influence the reproduction in elephants, because this is the first time Nepal is going to face it, and I think it was kind of say Nepal, they established that airport in Nizgarh, hopefully they won't. So the exact number I do not know, but it may have a direct influence on the physiological and reproductive state of female.
Okay, so somebody else was trying to ask a question. Can you please give it a go once again? I'm sorry, there were some technical problems.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, I can hear you.
Yep. Hi, Sanjita. I'm Amrita. I found your presentation very good. Was quite excellent.
Thank you.
You said in your presentation was quite relevant to current situation of built on animal habitat. As I'm quite familiar with this thing, but when I saw your presentation, I was quite curious to know about something based on animals like elephant. So could you tell me how can we identify the age of elephant? Like how could we know what is the age of elephant? Can you tell me about this?
Wonderful. Thank you for such nice question. Many time we tend to ignore such small details. And for today's presentation, I did not highlight how to identify the age class and how to identify elephants in that case. So age class, what we do is we measure the shoulder height. So the generally there is a table, there is a chart already prepared by Professor Raman Sukumar, which we use for the height differences. And but once you start observing elephants in the wild, and once you start following them in the wild, you tend to know that which elephant is adult, juvenile, subadult, or calf. So other than that, what I did was I also used the dung circumference. I think I was muted by Neeraj, by mistake, I think. Sorry. I also used the circumference of dung to measure the age class of elephants. So the larger the dung circumference, they are adult and subadult, juvenile, and calf. Regarding the identification of elephants, we generally use the ear venation pattern in the ears of elephant for the females. And in case of male, we use the tusk orientation, length of tusk, and then how, and also the other features like warts and all this stuff. And in case of macaque, again, we use the ear venation patterns to identify, and also the tail length and tail hair structure and all this minor detail that we have to closely observe elephants. That's how we identify elephants and also the age class in elephant.
Thank you, Sanjita. Thank you for the information.
Thank you.
So there's another question. Elephants are big in size, but their eyes are small. Is there a biological reason behind it?
Wow, wonderful. That's a very good question. So elephants generally have, sideways vision, and they have a very poor eyesight. So nature is such a, I don't know whether I should call nature or evolution in context, or evolution is such well planned that since they have a very poor eyesight, they have a very good sense of smell. And they can smell, so it is believed that they can even smell water. And so they have a very good sense of olfaction based on the trunk and all this thing. But yeah, like you said, their eyes are small and they have a very poor vision. But it's actually, compensated with the smelling capability of elephants.
Okay. So there's one more question and a comment. So thank you very much for a very nice presentation. Human-elephant interaction is unavoidable. Which method do you think is most effective in terms of reducing the negative interaction?
What did you say? The human-elephant contact is avoidable.
Unavoidable. So which method do you think is most effective in terms of reducing the negative interaction?
Well, it's a very big question, I would call it. It's like a conservation conundrum where every researcher, elephant researcher, is trying to answer that. Because many times what we do is, if you see in context of Nepal, India, and also other elephant ranging countries, they come up with many kind of mitigation measures. They think of, preventing elephant from entering human habitations and all. But most of the time, since elephants are very, very clever in learning and they have a very complex cognitive abilities, such problems, such mitigation measures doesn't last longer. So and that's the reason, people are trying to learn, they are trying to come up with something which is very sustainable. And in context of India, researchers are also planning to classify areas where elephants should be there, and whether areas where elephant can coexist with human, and areas where there is no human activities. So there are like three areas that India is planning to allocate. So with such kind of plan, such kind of strategy, we can also apply in context of Nepal. So, you know, to minimize the adverse elephant human interactions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There's one more question. Can animal passes substitute a natural form of the forest?
So like I said, the corridors, when I defined corridors, I said that it should be linear, it should be narrow, and it should not, you know, actually it should not support the residency of elephant. That elephant should not live in that corridor and give birth to a baby or stay there as a habitat. Then it's not called as at all as a corridor. It should be extremely narrow, that it should just facilitate the survivor and also the accelerated movement. It should not be the residency. But you know, the habitat quality and type that corridor has can be similar to the habitat patches that it is linking to. But it should not support the residency.
So the next question is, I heard that this Mishkad Airport project is more than 2 decades old. Is it because of conflict whether to conserve biodiversity and find the alternative of site, or there might be other reasons? In case of our country, there are less group of people who prefer to prioritize ecology over development. Community level awareness is must. So what responsible sectors are doing to address this issue? How concerned group of people can make difference in decision making level?
What was the latter part? Decision making? I did not hear it clearly.
How can concerned group of people make difference in decision making level?
Well, why? I think someone's mic is on. So yeah, so Mike, it's a very, why they halted this project, I have no idea. Could be, you know, and why they have reinitiated the project plan. But yeah, so like I also presented, and at the end I said that it is economic viability that people are looking into rather than ecological sustainability. And being a citizen of Nepal, I think rather than complaining about it, we should give a solid alternatives to government of Nepal. I hope they consider it. And you know, and to sensitive people. So you know, when I give this presentation to you guys, many people may be now knowing about the basic biology of elephants and how such project may get influenced, you know, may influence the health of elephants. So such ideas, I think we should keep on imparting our knowledge to people so that, you know, and in a large scale, we have limited time right now, so we should not wait for it. So that's how, you know, sensitize in writing articles, sensitize by talking to people in the ground level, and also sensitize, most importantly, sensitize people who are in the authority rather than, you know, those who can make a change rather than people who can't make a change.
Yeah. So one more question is, how long can elephants remember their dead ones?
That's a very interesting question. I think that has not been studied. I mean, how long, the exact time frame is not known. But there are studies on African elephants where they found that the bones of elephant, their relatives who died long back, and those bones were projected to them, particularly in context of captivity, and also played their sound when they played the sound of that elephant, and they projected the bone to that one of the study elephants. But they found that elephants showed interest in sniffing and all this thing. So that means they have a long-term memory associated with that elephants. But exact time frame, nobody knows. But yeah, the elephants are highly sentient and they can remember their, that's what the paper concluded, that, you know, they can remember their past, they can remember their dead elephants or related conspecific which died long back. But we do not know the exact time frame.
Okay. So I think we have there are 2 more questions. So are there evidence mm-hmm. that elephants may use underground passage?
So as for my knowledge, I have not come across that. Could be, but you know, it also depends on how we are going to do, what kind of underpass connectivity we are going to connect it, build it, and Yeah, so to my knowledge, I think I have not come across it. And I think it is more than underpass. I think in the overpass connectivity make more sense. But in case of Nizhgarh Airport, I think it's really unrealistic.
So the other question is, how concerned elephants are to avoid intra-family breeding among their adult siblings?
That's amazing. So this question I was expecting, and I think I missed this point when I was explaining about social organization. So like I said, when I was explaining about social organization, if you are listening to it, that males remain, once they get sexual maturity, they leave the natal herd. They leave their native herd and they move out of their herd and they remain solitary. So that is one of the evolutionary mechanism to control inbreeding. So, you know, that's a fantastic mechanism that evolution has created, that by default, once they get sexually mature, they leave their natal herd and they move out of the native herd, and that's how they, so there's no inbreeding incidences that happens in elephants. Or maybe, you know, accidentally, I think it has not been reported till date, but that's the natural phenomena of stopping or avoiding inbreeding. The male getting dispersed from the native herd.
So the one more question is, I heard that elephant has 36 teeth. Is it true?
Okay. Well, not exactly. So elephant teeth, they are actually quite jointed, if you can see. So it will be like this. I have not talked about it. So exact number, no, there is not 36, there is, we can't count that. But yeah, so they have a pattern, not like human teeth. And the incisor, you can see as a tusk, it is projecting out. And in case of female, it will be tusses. So they have tusks, but they will be having small tusses. But exact number is not 36, I don't think. So I'm sorry, I don't know the number about it.
So if there are any more questions, also unmute yourself and ask the questions. Okay. So this one, Dr. Pofrek, if you could share your publications, that would be great. So if you say any, please.
Sure, I'll do that. Whoever's interested, you can write to me, and you know, I can explain it to you in detail about stress physiology as well and share my publication.
So there's one more question from you. Does any corridor lie between the site of Nizhgarh Airport? And do changing the corridors, is that hard for the elephants, which leads to management issue for the airport?
Well, if you see, there's a report, there's one report from Nepal that they worked on, and they have defined the same strategic report 2015-2025. I think I request and recommend all of you to read that. And in that, they have mentioned about several corridors, mostly on the Baki Bardia side. And one of the corridors that they discussed about was Parsa Bagmati corridor. So if so is the case, since we have not studied, I did not find any research that has been done so far on elephant corridor in such in detail, like the rite of passage in context of India. But if so is the case, I think yes, it will influence badly, because if that parts of Parsa, and if you can see if you saw the map, you know, there are elephants, there are incidences, some of the scientific report that has been published from Nepal, they said that there are a movement of elephants towards Mohottari, Sarlahi, and then elephant going towards Kosi Tapu. So that means if such is the case, if elephants are moving through that passage, then that will have impact. Definitely have impact.
Okay, so one more question is, can you have, there is request for sharing your email address. So would be okay to type it on the chat forum. Okay, thank you.
All right.
So yeah, there are a lot of people who have Thank you for this wonderful and informative presentation. So even from our side, the organizer's side, from PowerShift Nepal and the Rethink Management Alliance, we'd really like to thank you for this presentation. So you've talked about a lot of things that are relevant to the Nizhgarh Airport. So I guess the main thing would be that the corridor that the elephants use for reproduction every year, that would be cleared out because of the airport, and also the pollution, especially the water and noise pollution that is created, would hamper in the communication of the elephants. And as we know that the adverse human elephant interaction is also bound to increase, especially like even if the elephants try to adjust their behavior for due to this obstruction, there will come a point when it is very likely that the interaction would turn negative. And also, one thing I personally found really interesting was that the stress physiology of the elephants is so much similar to that of humans.
And it's the same, actually, it's conserved in all mammals. So it is same for all the mammals. So we are also mammals. So we have the same physiological aspect.
About that, and one that you pointed out, and that having like a problem with the Nizhgarh airport project, is that, as you said, that they're saying that they're planning to plant 25 trees for every tree that is cut, and in a way that's a very unrealistic plan, because when you're cutting down old growth forests, we're cutting down an entire ecology, an entire ecosystem, and all the plants and animals that depend on it, and that you cannot just transport it to another place through new saplings. So thank you for this presentation.
Thanks, Salonika. Yeah, thank you, Salonika. And also, again, I would like to thank you and Neeraj in particular, because he kept on insisting me to talk about elephant behavior. And since I did not know much about what is happening at the ground in Nepal, because I'm here far away from Nepal, so I was a bit reluctant to keep. So that's where I restricted to elephants rather than to talk about policy and all this decision making that people would have been interested to know more.
Okay, so we just got one more question. So if you are interested, do you want to answer, or should I send the question to, through email, and I can contact the participant again with this? Okay, so the question is, what is the existing functional corridor? And the Department of National Park and Conservation Area has set it as existing functional corridor. Sanjay, would you like to explain this question?
What is existing functional corridor? Okay, so see, in terms of functional, so like I explained, I don't know whether you are saying what is existing functional corridor, or you are talking about which are the functional, existing functional corridor. It is not clear to me. But if you are asking about what is functional corridor, I have explained in explicitly about what corridors are, that, corridors should facilitate the movement of elephants. It should not facilitate the residency of elephants in that area, in that small patch of, it should be narrow. And it should facilitate the survival and the rapid movement of elephants. If that is a question, if you're asking about, and if you're asking about in context of Nepal, there are corridors, there are assigned corridors in Nepal, which has been actually in that Tal. If you see that report of Tal, you can see that there are certain corridors that they have explained it. But, elephant corridors, I did not come across that. If somebody has studied elephant corridor explicitly in Nepal, like how they have studied in Nepal, in India through rite of passes. So I don't know which, I think if it's not done, I think we should take this initiative to initiate this study of elephant corridor in Nepal. You're most welcome, Sanjay.
So thank you very much again. And thank you for your work in helping understand the importance of elephants to the ecology of the forest. So we hope
thank
that
you
would like to, we'd like to work with you further on this project or any other project. Thank you to all of the listeners and audiences for your very interesting questions and for your attendance. And we hope to work with you as well in the project of rethinking NISGUD.
Awesome. Thank you. Yeah.